Hello dear students, in this video I am continuing the next part of human reproduction. It is oogenesis. So like spermatogenesis, the type of the gametogenesis occurring in the females, it is oogenesis. The definition is process of formation of mature female gamete, that is egg, it is called oogenesis. The process of formation of mature female gamete is called oogenesis, and the very important term to remember is it is initiated during embryonic development stage. That means when the female fetus is growing within the womb of mother, during that embryonic stage itself the oogenesis is initiated. And during the embryonic development itself, the millions of gamete mother cells, so for spermatogenesis it is referred as spermatogonia, and here with respect to oogenesis, millions of gamete mother cells called oogonia are formed in the fetal ovary. That means in the ovary of developing fetus, when it is still present in the womb of mother, millions of oogonial cells are formed. And another very important term to remember, no more oogonia are formed or added after the birth. Once the female fetus is delivered, fully grown female fetus is delivered, after birth in the ovary of female there is no formation of oogonia, because whatever the number of oogonia are required, all of them are produced during the embryonic developmental stage itself. Once the birth occurs in the female child, there will be no further production of oogonia or the gamete mother cells to produce the egg or ovum. Some of the oogonia which are produced in the ovary, they form primary oocyte. Why the term is oocyte? Because here studying about oogenesis. If it is a spermatogenesis, the term is spermatocyte. Some of the oogonia which are produced inside the ovary during the embryonic development stage, they function as primary oocyte, and that oogonia undergoes meiosis and get arrested at the prophase 1. These cells represents primary oocyte. Then question is, how to define primary oocyte? It is the oogonia which has entered into meiosis and arrested at the stage of prophase 1. That means the meiosis division is not completed. Just it has entered the meiosis, which is meiosis 1, and the cell is arrested at prophase 1. Such cells are called primary oocyte. And remember, primary oocyte is nothing but it is the oogonium, and it has entered into the meiosis, but it has arrested at the stage of prophase 1. So now the terms are, each primary oocyte gets surrounded by a layer of granulosa cells, and now it is called primary follicle. What is the difference between primary oocyte and primary follicle? Primary oocyte is the structure which is developing from oogonium and arrested at the prophase 1. The same primary oocyte, when it gets surrounded by granulosa cells, it is called primary follicle. Without granulosa cells, the structure is referred as primary oocyte. When primary oocyte is surrounded by granulosa cells, it is called primary follicle. A large number of primary follicles get generated between birth and puberty, because before birth of the female child only, the oogonia are completely produced. Millions of oogonia are produced within the fetus ovary. After birth, what happens? These oogonial cells or primary follicles, they undergo maturity to produce the egg. But what happens? Maximum primary follicles, they are generated from the period of birth to attaining the sexual maturity, that is nothing but puberty. What is primary follicle? It is the primary oocyte surrounded by a layer of granulosa cells. And these primary follicles, they have to undergo proliferation. Proliferation means structural change. Primary follicle is converted into secondary follicle. Secondary follicle is converted into tertiary follicle. And tertiary follicle is converted into mature Graafian follicle. And in that mature Graafian follicle, the female gamete, egg, is present. This conversion occurs at the time of puberty. Remember, already in the ovary of a female baby, the primary follicles are produced. And these primary follicles, they undergo conversion when that girl reaches the stage of puberty. But number of follicles are degenerated, then finally, at puberty, how many primary follicles remain in the ovary? Answer is from 60,000 to 80,000. Million number is reduced to 60,000 to 80,000. Only this much of primary follicles, they are left in the ovary of female at the stage of puberty. When female reaches the stage of puberty in her ovary, what is the number of primary follicles? Answer is 60,000 to 80,000. So moving to the next one. The primary follicle, now it is getting surrounded by more layer of granulosa cells as well as new membranes called theca, and this structure is called secondary follicle. Let me clear the three terms. Primary oocyte, it is the oogonium entered into the meiosis and arrested at the prophase 1. When primary oocyte is surrounded by granulosa cells, it is primary follicle. When primary follicle is surrounded by more layers of granulosa as well as theca, means new layers, when the theca formation occurs, the structure is defined as secondary follicle. Oogonia, primary oocyte, primary follicle, and primary follicle, when it is surrounded by more granulosa cells and theca, it is called secondary follicle. Then, the secondary follicle gives rise to the development of tertiary follicle, and the tertiary follicle is characterized by the presence of a fluid-filled cavity called antrum. See, you can see the changes. What are the things that I am explaining? This is the transverse section of ovary. Here you can see the smaller cells, they are primary follicles. Primary follicles are growing. Their conversion into secondary follicle and secondary to tertiary to mature follicle, it is influenced by a pituitary hormone called FSH, follicle stimulating hormone. This follicle stimulating hormone, it converts the primary follicle into secondary follicle into tertiary follicle. So primary follicle is covered by a granulosa layer, secondary follicle is covered by granulosa as well as theca. When secondary follicle develops, here you can see the cavity. Inside the secondary follicle, when a fluid-filled cavity develops, it is called the tertiary follicle. That means tertiary follicle contains granulosa cells, theca, as well as a fluid-filled cavity called antrum. And at the stage of tertiary follicle, the theca is originated into two layers. Here, the two distinct layers can be seen. Inner one is called theca interna and outer one is called theca externa. Differentiation of the theca into two layers, it is very, very evident at the stage of tertiary follicle. So, oogonium gives rise to the formation of primary oocyte, which is arrested at the prophase 1. When primary oocyte is surrounded by granulosa, it is primary follicle. When primary follicle is surrounded by the granulosa as well as theca, it is secondary follicle. And when secondary follicle develops, a fluid-filled cavity called antrum with the two distinct theca layers, theca interna and theca externa, it is nothing but tertiary follicle. So here, the primary oocyte, now it is growing in size and now it completes first meiotic division. And first meiotic division is unequal, forming a large secondary oocyte and a tiny first polar body. Division of the primary oocyte is unequal. It produces one large cell called secondary oocyte and a small structure called first polar body. The secondary oocyte retains much nutrient and rich in cytoplasm. That is why its size is bigger. The tertiary follicle changes into mature graafian follicle. What is the name for mature follicle? It is graafian follicle. And now the secondary oocyte, which is growing inside the graafian follicle, it forms a new layer around itself called zona pellucida, and it is called zona pellucida. The graafian follicle now ruptures to release the secondary oocyte from the ovary by the process called ovulation. So secondary follicle, when it contains the fluid filled cavity antrum, when it shows theca interna and theca externa, it is tertiary follicle. Once the tertiary follicle becomes the primary oocyte, inside that tertiary follicle, it completes the first meiosis and it is unequal division, forming a large secondary oocyte and a small polar body. The secondary oocyte, its structure is larger because it contains more nutrient and cytoplasm. Now the tertiary follicle changes, it is attaining maturity and it is transformed into graafian follicle. The secondary oocyte forms a new layer around itself called zona pellucida. Inside the graafian follicle, this is the structure of graafian follicle, and the cell which is present inside the graafian follicle is nothing but secondary oocyte. That you have to remember very importantly. And this secondary oocyte, when it is released from the graafian follicle, the graafian follicle ruptures. When graafian follicle ruptures, it releases the secondary oocyte from the ovary. Process is called ovulation. Very, very important 1 mark question. Define ovulation, or what is ovulation? The release of secondary oocyte due to rupturing of graafian follicle from the ovary, the process is called ovulation. And remember, the ovulation is influenced by the pituitary hormone LH, that is luteinizing hormone. So here, this is follicle near the maturity, and here it is mature graafian follicle, because the growth is completed. When this graafian follicle ruptures, it releases the egg or ovum, which is at secondary oocyte stage, which is in the secondary oocyte stage. Once the graafian follicle ruptures and ovulation is completed, the graafian follicle is transformed into irregular structure called corpus luteum, and this corpus luteum secretes a hormone, progesterone. After the rupturing of graafian follicle, which structure is produced? Answer is corpus luteum. And corpus luteum secretes a hormone called progesterone. This is how the changes occur in the structure of primary follicle to produce the female gamete egg during oogenesis. It is schematic representation of oogenesis. Again, 3 mark question. The schematic representation of spermatogenesis as well as oogenesis, both of them are important. It is initiated by a oogonium, which increases its number by the mitosis. The chromosome number in the primary oocyte is 46. In the oogonium as well as primary oocyte is 46, because it is dividing through the mitosis. This primary oocyte completes the first meiosis and gives rise to the formation of two structures. Larger one is the secondary oocyte and smaller one is the first polar body, and both of them are the haploid structures. They contain 23 chromosomes. Secondary oocyte also undergo the unequal division and gives rise to the formation of female gamete egg, and this is the second polar body produced from secondary oocyte. Not only secondary oocyte is undergoing the division, it is not mentioned in the schematic representation, from the first polar body also two more polar bodies are produced. So at the end of oogenesis, totally 3 polar bodies and 1 egg is produced. And this egg is developing inside the follicle cell. When the development is completed, the mature follicle is called graafian follicle. And from this one, egg is released at the secondary oocyte stage. So when ovulation is completed, remember, the egg which is released from the graafian follicle, it is in the secondary oocyte stage. So these are the things that I wanted to explain with respect to oogenesis. I hope it is clear for you. Thank you. Hello dear students, in this video I am going to continue the next part of human reproduction. It is menstrual cycle. In the previous video I explained about the development of female gamete ovum in the ovary. The cells of the ovary which produce the female gamete egg are called follicle cells. And follicle cell production is completed before the birth of female child, that means during the embryonic development. after the birth of a female child during the puberty, only these follicle cells undergo maturation. The primary follicle gets transformed into secondary to tertiary, and tertiary to mature follicle. The mature follicle is called Graafian follicle. It is surrounded by two wall layers, theca externa and theca interna. The cavity present in the Graafian follicle is called antrum. It is a fluid filled cavity present in the Graafian follicle. It is called antrum. And once the Graafian follicle is formed, under the influence of pituitary hormone LH, the egg is released from the Graafian follicle, and the process is called ovulation. So this is very important part of the chapter. It is 5-mark question. So let us move to the details of menstrual cycle. What is a menstrual cycle? Already you have studied this term in the first chapter, reproduction in organisms. The menstrual cycle represents reproductive cycle in the female primates like monkey, apes and human beings. Whereas in case of non-primates, the reproductive cycle is called estrus cycle. Whereas in case of primates, the reproductive cycle is called menstrual cycle. The reproductive cycle of non-primates is estrus cycle, and the reproductive cycle of primates is menstrual cycle. What is the definition of menstrual cycle? The cycle of events starting from one menstruation till the next one is called menstrual cycle. When the menstrual cycle begins, from that period, some cyclic events will be occurring within the female reproductive system till the next cycle. All those events are together called menstrual cycle. And this cycle is essential for the production of oocytes. That means the conversion of primary follicle to secondary to tertiary, like that, and for the preparation of uterus for the purpose of pregnancy. So what is the meaning of this sentence here? During the menstrual cycle, the two types of changes are taking place. One inside the ovary and another is within the uterus. The cyclic events are occurring both within the ovary as well as within the uterus. Uterus is also subjected to cyclic changes. Ovary is also subjected to cyclic changes, and this cycle is repeated for on an average 28 to 35 days, and normally one egg is released per cycle. Every menstrual cycle is normally repeated on an average 28 to 35 days, and during every menstrual cycle, one egg is released from the ovary. So try to remember, during the menstrual cycle, the cyclic events are occurring both in the ovary as well as in the uterus. So ovary is producing the female gamete egg, so that it is undergoing cyclic changes. Uterus is the part where the infant grows, the embryo grows. So both these structures are subjected to cyclic changes during the menstrual cycle. So two important terms for 1-mark question. What is a menarche? Menarche is the first menstruation for a human female, and it begins at puberty. That means when a female child is born, after the birth, immediately there will be no menstrual cycle. Even during the old age, the menstrual cycle is absent. Only during the puberty stage, the menstrual cycle occurs. And when the first menstrual cycle begins at the puberty, it is called menarche. The actual age of menarche varies from person to person, but menarche signals beginning of the reproductive age in the females. Once the menstrual cycle initiates, it is the indication of beginning of reproductive age in the females. So that means the female can undergo the reproduction. Similarly, one more term, menopause. Menopause is the permanent ceasing of menstrual cycle in the females due to depletion of oocytes as a result of aging. That means from birth, after the birth, when the female is in puberty, in her body the menstrual cycle is started. When she reaches the old age, the menstrual cycle is permanently stopped. Ceasing means permanent stop, and this stage or the condition is called menopause. And menopause age is varying. The average age of the menopause is 45 to 50 years. Near the age of 50, around 50 years, the menstrual cycle is permanently stopped in the females, and that permanent ceasing of menstrual cycle is called menopause. So both the terms are very important. One mark questions: the beginning of first menstruation in the human females at puberty is called menarche. The permanent ceasing of the menstrual cycle in the human females during old age is called menopause. So these are the terms with respect to menstrual cycle, expected for one mark. The next one, menstrual cycle is studied with respect to four phases: menstrual phase, follicular phase, ovulation phase or simply ovulation, and luteal phase. So these are the four phases with respect to the menstrual cycle. Here is the representation of menstrual cycle and what is the level of hormone during the different phases and what are the hormones secreted. This is the primary follicle. Slowly it gets transformed into mature follicle, that is graafian follicle, and this conversion is influenced by the pituitary hormones FSH and LH. Here you can see the number is mentioned between 13 to 15, that is 14th. The level of LH is high. So here the line, little green line, what you can see in the image, it is showing the hormone, luteinizing hormone. During middle of the cycle, the LH level is completely high, and here you can see when LH level is high, the graafian follicle ruptures and releases the egg. It is ovulation, and ruptured graafian follicle transformed into a structure called corpus luteum. It remains for few days. If there is no pregnancy, again there is menstruation, and here the menses, it is the removal of endometrium along with the blood, and slowly the thickness of the endometrium increases during the cycle of menstruation. So this is what is the level of hormone during different phases of menstrual cycle. So let us go for the details. Menstrual phase. This is the first phase of menstrual cycle, and this is the period of menstruation when the menstrual flow occurs. The first phase of the menstrual cycle, during which the menstrual flow occurs. For how many days it is represented? Typically, it is lasting for 3 to 5 days. The average time for menstrual phase taken is 3 to 5 days. Then question is, what happens during the menstrual phase? During the menstrual phase, how many days are taken for menstrual phase? 3 to 5 days. And during the menstrual phase, what happens? Breakdown of endometrial lining of the uterus and its blood vessels, which forms a liquid, and that comes out through the vagina. So two terms are mentioned here: endometrial lining. What is endometrium? The uterus is lined by 3 wall layers. Outer one is perimetrium, middle one is myometrium, inner one is endometrium. This is the fertile layer of the uterus. This endometrial lining, it sheds out, it breaks down. Along with that, the blood vessels, both of them forms a liquid, and this is coming out through the part of the female external genitalia called vagina. This is called menses. The broken endometrium, along with its blood vessels, which is removed through the vagina, it represents menses, and that phase is called menstrual phase. The menstrual phase occurs when the egg or ovum released by the ovary is not fertilized. If fertilization is absent, then that unfertilized egg, it is removed from the female reproductive system through the menstrual cycle. That is why the lack of menstruation, if the menstrual cycle is absent, it may be the indication of pregnancy. Not all the time. Sometimes the menstrual cycle will be delayed, even though there is no fertilization and pregnancy, because of stress, hormonal imbalance, poor diet, and poor health. These are the some conditions that affect the regular menstrual cycle. Every time when the menstrual cycle is absent, it doesn't mean that the female is in the pregnancy condition. But the absence or lack of menstrual cycle, it may be the indication, or it is the indication of pregnancy. But sometimes menstrual cycle is delayed, or it takes the cycle will be altered for long period. That may be due to stress, poor diet, and poor health. Basically due to hormonal impairment. Then second phase is follicular phase. So 2 points here you need to remember very clearly. What happens during the menstrual phase? How many days it takes? It is represented for 3 to 5 days. During menstrual phase, the breakdown of endometrial lining of the uterus along with its blood vessels occur, that forms a liquid which comes out through the vagina. And ovum, which is not fertilized, it is the indication of, sorry, if the ovum is not fertilized, definitely it is released from the, removed from the female reproductive system through the menstrual phase. Then follicular phase. This is the phase of maturation of follicles. So in the previous slide here I told, so these are the follicles which undergo maturation under the influence of a hormone called FSH. So here the primary follicles, where they are present inside the ovary, under the influence of FSH, they fully grow into mature graafian follicle. So what happens during the follicular phase? During the follicular phase, the primary follicle is transformed into mature graafian follicle. And one more very important term to remember, endometrium of the uterus regenerates through the proliferation. Why the endometrium is regenerated? Because during the menstrual phase, the endometrial lining, it is removed. It is shedded during the menstrual phase. So that endometrium is regenerated. Once again, it is formed within the uterus. These changes in the ovary. So primary follicle growth into mature graafian follicle is occurring inside the ovary. This is one very important part. At the same time, endometrial growth is occurring inside the uterus. That is why in the beginning I told, during the menstrual cycle, the changes are occurring inside the ovary as well as the uterus. Follicle maturation is occurring inside the ovary and endometrial shedding and regeneration occurs inside the uterus. These changes in the ovary and uterus are induced by ovarian hormones as well as pituitary hormones. The female sex hormones secreted by ovary, they are the ovarian hormones, and the pituitary hormones FSH and LH, follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone, both of them are influencing these changes which are taking place inside the ovary as well as uterus. The levels of gonadotrophins gradually increase through the follicular phase. Gonadotrophins. Which hormones are called gonadotrophins? Here you can see the red line in this image is representing the level of FSH, and this green line is indicating the level of LH. Both FSH and LH are called the gonadotrophins. Gonadotrophins are nothing but these are the hormones which stimulate the functioning of gonads. Then what are the gonads? Gamete producing organs. Once again, here I would like to mark, slowly you can see the increase in the thickness of endometrium. And about which phase I am explaining here? Follicular phase, which is also known as proliferative phase. Why it is called proliferation? Here, step by step changes can be observed in the development of primary follicle to graafian follicle. So during the follicular phase, the level of the gonadotrophins is very high, FSH as well as LH. Increased level of LH and FSH, that is gonadotrophins, stimulate the follicular development. They also stimulate the secretion of estrogen. What is this estrogen? It is the hormone secreted from ovary. Estrogen is secreted by the ovary and by the growing follicle. So let me clear one important sentence here. The mature graafian follicle secretes the hormone called estrogen, and this is the female sex hormone. These are the things that are occurring during follicular phase. Again, I would like to repeat, menstrual phase lasts for 3 to 5 days. During the menstrual phase, the breakdown of endometrial lining of the uterus along with its blood vessels occur, which forms a liquid that comes out of the vagina. During the menstrual phase, the unfertilized ovum is removed from the female body The absence of menstruation may be the indication of pregnancy, but sometimes the menstrual cycle is affected or delayed due to stress, poor diet and poor health. During follicular phase, the primary follicles are maturing into graafian follicle. Endometrium of the uterus is regenerated, and these changes are influenced by ovarian hormones as well as pituitary hormones. The pituitary hormones are FSH and LH. Both the levels are very high during the follicular phase. Even estrogen is also secreted by the growing follicle. Then remaining two phases, the third phase is ovulatory phase or ovulation phase. This is the phase of release of ovum from ovary. When egg is released from the ovary, it is called the ovulation. During this phase here, the levels of LH and FSH reach their peak at the mid cycle around 14th day. This term is very important, 14th day. When does the ovulation occur during menstrual cycle? On the 14th day. Why? Because in the middle of the cycle, on an average, if we consider 28 day of cycle, 14th day is the mid cycle period. During 14th day, there is a rapid increase in the level of LH. Luteinizing hormone level increases, and this LH induces the release of egg from graafian follicle. This is called LH surge. Another very important term in the chapter. It may be asked for 1 mark question or give reason why the ovulation occurs during the 14th day of menstrual cycle due to LH surge. Exactly on the 14th day of menstrual cycle, the level of LH increases, and this induces rupture of graafian follicle, thereby the release of ovum. Definitely, when graafian follicle ruptures, the egg is released from the graafian follicle. And remember, when the egg is released from the graafian follicle, it is at secondary oocyte stage. That means it has completed first meiosis, so it is haploid in condition, but it is at the secondary oocyte, not yet completed the second meiosis. Then ovulation definition, 1 mark question. The process by which an ovum is released by mature graafian follicle from the ovary. It is the result of LH surge, which occurs during mid cycle around the 14th day. The process by which an ovum is released by a mature graafian follicle from the ovary, it is called the ovulation. Therefore, the hormone inducing the ovulation, hormone responsible for ovulation, is LH. Remember, LH is a pituitary hormone. It is not secreted by the ovary. Expansion of LH is luteinizing hormone. It is belonging to the group of gonadotropins. Then last phase, luteal phase. What happens during this phase? This phase is the formation of corpus luteum. So here in the image you can see, this is the graafian follicle. Mature follicle is nothing but graafian follicle. From the graafian follicle, the egg or ovum is released. So completed process is ovulation. Look at the level of LH, it is high. The term used for high level of LH, during mid cycle is LH surge. After ovulation, the ruptured graafian follicle, it forms a structure called corpus luteum. That is why the stage name is luteal phase. The remaining part of the graafian follicle, after ovulation, it forms the corpus luteum. Then what is its function? Once the corpus luteum is formed, it secretes large amounts of progesterone, which is essential for the maintenance of endometrium. So during menstrual phase, the endometrium is broken down and it is removed. During follicular phase, the endometrium is regenerated, and that regenerated endometrium thickness, it is maintained during the luteal phase, and it is maintained with the help of the hormone called progesterone. The endometrium maintenance is very, very necessary for implantation of fertilized ovum and even for other events of pregnancy. If the fertilization occurs, if the zygote is formed and that zygote is developing into blastocyst, and that blastocyst gets attached to the endometrium, this process is implantation. By chance, if the fertilization occurs, the fertilized ovum is supported through the attachment process called implantation. And for that implantation, the endometrium of the uterus is very, very essential. Even it participates in the formation of placenta, which is helping in the maintenance of pregnancy. So corpus luteum is nothing but it is the remaining part of the graafian follicle. After ovulation, it secretes the hormone called progesterone, which helps in the maintenance of endometrium and other events of pregnancy. These are the four phases that you need to remember with respect to the menstrual cycle. Again, I am reminding, the menstrual cycle is important question for 5 marks. So try to concentrate on the terms and make the practice of explanation. This part not necessary to mention in the answer. During pregnancy, what happens? All the events of menstrual cycle are stopped and there is no menstruation. If the female is in the pregnancy condition, if the egg released from graafian follicle is fertilized by the sperm, in that situation the menstrual cycle is temporarily stopped and pregnant females do not get the menstrual cycle. Then in the absence of pregnancy, if there is no fertilization, egg is released by the graafian follicle but it is not fertilized, that means the absence of pregnancy. In the absence of pregnancy, this causes breakdown of endometrium. If there is no fertilization, if there is no pregnancy, again cycle is repeated, leading to the breakdown of endometrium and menstruation, and this indicates the starting of new cycle. So here what I would like to explain is, in pregnant females the menstrual cycle is temporarily stopped. If there is no pregnancy, there is no fertilization of the egg by the sperm, in that case regularly the cycle is repeated. Again there will be breaking of endometrium, again there will be flow of liquid from the vagina, it is followed by follicular phase. The primary follicle gets matured into graafian follicle. Under the influence of LH, it releases the egg, and that graafian follicle is transformed into corpus luteum. The cyclic events are continued if there is no fertilization and pregnancy. If the female is in the pregnancy condition, the menstrual cycle is temporarily stopped. So all these are the things that you need to remember with respect to menstrual cycle. The important definitions are menstrual cycle, menarche, menopause, LH surge, ovulation, corpus luteum, hormone secreted by the corpus luteum, and what is its function. I hope this explanation is clear for you. Thank you. Hello dear students. In this video, I am continuing the next part of human reproduction, that is role of hormones in regulation of spermatogenesis. So what is spermatogenesis? It is a process which occurs in the human male body and result in the production of haploid male gametes called sperms. The site of the spermatogenesis is seminiferous tubules of testis, and it is started by male germ cells called spermatogonial cells. First, they multiply by the mitosis and gives rise to the formation of number of spermatogonial cells. One among them will continue in the next process and get converted into primary spermatocyte. That primary spermatocyte undergo meiosis to produce a secondary spermatocyte. The two secondary spermatocytes, they divide by meiosis II and gives rise to the formation of spermatids. But spermatids are not the actual sperms. Finally, they get transformed into the functional sperms through the process called spermiogenesis. So how this spermatogenesis is regulated in males? Spermatogenesis, it starts at the age of puberty. When the male reaches the age of puberty, due to significant increase in the secretion of gonadotropin releasing hormone of hypothalamus. What is the GnRH? Its expansion is gonadotropin releasing hormone. This hormone is secreted from hypothalamus. When GnRH reaches the pituitary, from the pituitary two more hormones are secreted, and all this phenomenon or the process, it starts at the age of puberty. So at the age of puberty, the significant increase occurs in the secretion of GnRH of the hypothalamus, and this GnRH, gonadotropin releasing hormone, it stimulates the anterior pituitary gland to secrete two gonadotropins. They are LH, luteinizing hormone, and follicle stimulating hormone. So first hypothalamus secretes GnRH. That GnRH, it acts on anterior pituitary. From the anterior pituitary, two hormones are secreted, FSH and LH. LH, luteinizing hormone, FSH, follicle stimulating hormone. So now, what is the function of LH? LH acts on Leydig cells, which are also called interstitial cells. They are present in between the seminiferous tubules, which is called interstitial space. That is why the Leydig cells are also called interstitial cells. When LH acts on Leydig cells, the Leydig cells are stimulated to release the male sex hormones called androgens. So androgen secretion from the Leydig cells is influenced by increased level of LH, and androgens in turn stimulate the process of spermatogenesis. This is the function of LH. what is the function of LH or what is the role of LH in the spermatogenesis? LH acts on the Leydig cells and it stimulates the secretion of androgens. Androgens in turn stimulate the process of spermatogenesis. Then what is the function of FSH? FSH acts on the Sertoli cells. Where do you find the Sertoli cells? Sertoli cells are present within the seminiferous tubules. The germinal epithelium of the seminiferous tubules produces the male germ cells and Sertoli cells. Sertoli cells are also called nurse cells as they provide nourishment to the male germ cells during the spermatogenesis. And this Sertoli cell, when it is stimulated by FSH, its secretions help in the process of spermiogenesis. Again, the term is important. What is spermiogenesis? It is a transformation of spermatids into actual sperms. And this spermiogenesis is influenced by the secretions of Sertoli cells. So both the hormones are very important. Remember, LH acts on the Leydig cells, whereas FSH acts on the Sertoli cells. Both of them are contributing in the regulation of spermatogenesis. So here is the schematic representation. In the image, you can see from the hypothalamus of forebrain, the GnRH is secreted, that is gonadotropin releasing hormone. This GnRH stimulates anterior pituitary. From the anterior pituitary, two hormones are secreted, FSH and LH. Both of them are acting on the testis. LH acts on the Leydig cells, which are also called interstitial cells. And when Leydig cells are stimulated by the LH, it secretes the testosterone. And testosterone, it controls or it acts, stimulates spermatogenesis. Then thus FSH is stimulating the Sertoli cells, and from the Sertoli cells, certain contents are secreted. It also secretes the hormone inhibin, and inhibin acts as inhibitory hormone for the production of GnRH and FSH. When Sertoli cells are highly stimulated, when FSH level increases, the inhibin hormone is secreted from the Sertoli cells. Then this inhibin has the inhibitory effect on the secretion of FSH as well as gonadotropin releasing hormone. At the same time, when testosterone level increases, testosterone is major androgen. When testosterone level increases, its increased level inhibits the secretion of LH from the pituitary, as well as it inhibits the hypothalamus to reduce the secretion of GnRH. So both testosterone and inhibin have inhibitory effect on the GnRH production from hypothalamus. This is how these hormones are regulating the spermatogenesis in males. So try to remember the explanation and make the practice. Schematic representation also you need to practice. This is 3-mark question. Hope it is clear. Hello dear students, in this video I am continuing next part of human reproduction, and it is about fertilization. So fertilization and implantation, it is the next bit of the topic human reproduction. In humans, during fertilization or before fertilization, the process required to execute the fertilization is insemination. What is this insemination? The semen is released by the penis into the vagina during copulation, also called coitus or sexual intercourse. So during sexual intercourse, semen is released into the vagina and this process is called insemination. Once the insemination is completed, the motile sperms, which are very active and motile, they swim rapidly, pass through the cervix, they reaches the uterus and finally reach the ampullary region of fallopian tube. The first step is insemination, during which semen is released into the vagina. Motile sperms, which swim rapidly, they pass through the cervix, they reach the uterus and finally they reach the ampullary region. What is this ampullary region? It is wider part of fallopian tube. The fallopian tube is accessory duct of female reproductive system. And this fallopian tube is also called oviduct. It consists of infundibulum, ampulla, isthmus, and infundibulum is having the finger-like projections called fimbriae. The ampullary region of the fallopian tube is wider region. The sperms which are deposited into the female reproductive tract during the sexual intercourse, they move through the different parts like cervix and uterus. Finally, they reach the ampullary region. At the same time, the ovum or egg released by ovary through the ovulation is also transported to ampullary region, where the fertilization takes place. So what is the site of fertilization in humans? It is ampullary region. The sperm and egg, if they come in contact with each other in the ampullary region of a fallopian tube, the fertilization is executed. The ampullary region of the fallopian tube is site of fertilization in case of human beings. Here, one thing is required to execute the fertilization. Fertilization can only occur if the egg and sperm are transported simultaneously to the ampullary region, because once the sperms are discharged or released into the female reproductive tract, the fertility capacity of the sperm is only for 48 hours. And once the egg is released from the ovary after ovulation, the fertility capacity is only for 24 hours. Within this period, the sperm and egg, they must come in contact with each other at the ampullary region. Then only it can result in the fertilization. That is why all the copulations do not lead to the fertilization and pregnancy. So once this is asked in the examination, why every fertilization and every copulation does not need lead to fertilization and pregnancy? Because once the sperm is transported simultaneously, egg should also reach the ampullary region. If both of them reaches the ampullary region within time, it will result in the execution of a fertilization and leads to the pregnancy. Then the process of fusion of sperm with an ovum or egg is called fertilization. And during fertilization, the sperm comes in contact with the egg. and yug is surrounded by yug membrane called zona pellucida, and it induces the changes in the membrane that blocks the entry of additional sperm. So let me explain about this sentence. If one fastly moving sperm, millions of the sperms are discharged, one among them which is highly motile, first it comes in contact with the egg, and egg is covered by two membranes, corona radiata and zona pellucida. Later in the next slide we will come to know about that, corona radiata and zona pellucida. Once one sperm enters into the egg, the zona pellucida, it blocks the entry of additional sperms. So only one sperm is allowed to enter into the egg to execute the fertilization. This is called monospermy. Entry of single sperm into the egg is called monospermy, and polyspermy is prevented by changes in the membrane structure of zona pellucida. And this ensures the same thing, only one sperm can fertilize the ovum. The secretions of acrosome help the sperm enter into the cytoplasm through the zona pellucida and plasma membrane. When sperm comes in contact with the egg, acrosome of the sperm releases some enzymes, and those enzymes break the egg membrane so that the sperm can enter into the cytoplasm of female gamete egg. Here it is very important, I hope you remember, at the time of ovulation, the egg is released at secondary oocyte stage. The secondary oocyte, what is it? It is a haploid structure, just it has completed first meiotic division, yet it has not completed second meiotic division. Then question is, when does that second meiosis is completed? Once the sperm enters into the egg, or when the sperm is trying to enter into the egg, at that time the second meiotic division is carried out by secondary oocyte. At the time of sperm entry into the egg, the second meiotic division is completed by the secondary oocyte. And remember, the second meiosis is also unequal and result in the formation of one second polar body and a haploid structure called ovum or ootid. And here the ootid is the functional egg. Spermatids are not the functional sperms, but the ootid which is produced, it is the functional egg. Its nucleus fuses with the nucleus of sperm and gives rise to the formation of diploid zygote. Once again, I would like to revise the things. Before fertilization, the insemination is required in human beings, and during insemination, the semen is released into the vagina. Motile sperms, they pass through the cervix, reach the uterus, and finally reaches the ampullary region of fallopian tube. At the same time, egg should also reach the ampullary region of the fallopian tube where the fertilization takes place. Once the sperm come in contact with the egg, the acrosome secretes some enzymes, and those enzymes help in the breaking of egg membranes, corona radiata and zona pellucida. Once the one sperm enters into the egg, the entry of other sperms is prevented by modified zona pellucida. When the sperm tries to enter into the egg, or when it enters into the egg, at that time the secondary oocyte undergoes second meiotic division, and second meiotic division is unequal, result in the formation of a smaller second polar body and one larger haploid ovum or ootid. Finally, nucleus of the sperm and nucleus of the egg fuses with each other and gives rise to the formation of zygote. Remember, all these phenomenon or the processes, they are occurring at the ampullary region. The zygote formation also occurs at the ampullary region, because a sperm and egg, they have fused with each other at the ampullary region, so that the zygote formation is also occurring at the ampullary region. Then moving to the next one, this I will go for later, and I will explain the things with the help of this one. Yes, let us go for the explanation here. So during insemination, what happens? The semen is released into the vagina. What is semen? It is a mixture of seminal plasma with the sperms. What is seminal plasma? It is the mixture or the content of three accessory glands of male reproductive system. What are those? Seminal vesicles, Cooper's gland, and bulbo urethral, Cooper's gland and prostate gland. Seminal vesicles, prostate gland, and Cooper's glands or bulbourethral glands. The secretion of these glands represents seminal plasma. When sperms combine with that seminal plasma, it forms the semen, and semen is released into the vagina at the time of insemination. Then what happens? After insemination, motile sperms, they pass through the cervix, then they enter into uterus, and finally they reach the ampullary region. At the same time, the egg released by ovary also reaches ampullary region. That means the sperm and egg, now they are present at the ampullary region, they undergo fertilization. Therefore, site of fertilization in humans is ampullary region. So here let me explain about this diagram. This is the diagrammatic representation of female gamete egg. It is surrounded by the three protective layers. Outer one is corona radiata, next to that is zona pellucida. Below the zona pellucida, plasma membrane is present. In between plasma membrane and zona pellucida, there is a small space called perivitelline space, and the zona pellucida structure changes once the sperm enters into the egg. Here you can see the haploid nucleus of the female gamete egg. So some sperms, they are trying to reach the egg. Already this sperm has reached the egg. Acrosome of the sperm releases some enzymes so that it can break the corona radiata, it can break the zona pellucida. Finally, the sperm enters into the cytoplasm of egg through zona pellucida and plasma membrane. When the sperm enters into the egg, the secondary oocyte, which is just completed, which has completed the meiosis one, now it will complete the second meiotic division. Once the sperm enters into the egg, at the time of fertilization, the secondary oocyte completes second meiotic division, and second meiotic division is unequal. It produces one smaller polar body and one larger ootid. That ootid itself is functional ovum. I hope it is clear. One more very important term you need to remember: zona pellucida and corona radiata. These are specifically called egg membranes because they are present around the female gamete egg. Therefore, they are called egg membranes. What are the egg membranes, or name the egg membranes? Corona radiata and zona pellucida. Between the plasma membrane of egg and zona pellucida, there is a small space called perivetelline space. Why the name is perivetelline? In frog egg, instead of zona pellucida, vetelline membrane is present at the second position, that means the second layer, so that with comparison to vetelline membrane of a frog egg, here the space between plasma membrane and zona pellucida is called perivetelline space. So moving to the next one, yes, this is important. Human female is represented by the karyotype. What is karyotype? Type of the chromosomes in her body. The karyotype is 44A plus XX. This is plus, don't consider this as X. 44A plus XX, and male is represented by 44A plus XY. That means female in humans, she is producing only one type of the eggs throughout her life. That means till the end of menstrual cycle or till reaching the menopause condition, she is producing all the eggs carrying only X chromosome. That means human female is homogametic. She is producing only one type of the egg. All the eggs are carrying only X chromosome. Then what about the male? So male is having one X chromosome and one Y chromosome. Therefore, male produces two types of the sperms. Male produces two types of the sperms. Half of the sperms carry X chromosome and half of the sperms carry Y chromosome. Then what happens? At the time of fertilization, if egg is fertilized by the sperm carrying X chromosome, what is the type of chromosome in egg? It is X chromosome. What type of the chromosome is carried by the sperm? It is also X. Then it becomes XX. This result in the development of female child. If the egg is fertilized by the sperm carrying X chromosome, the resultant combination of the chromosomes becomes XX, and it leads to the development of a female child. This is one option. If egg is fertilized by the sperm carrying Y chromosome, then after fertilization, the combination of the chromosomes is X and Y, and this gives rise to the formation of a male. Therefore, here egg is not important because egg carry only the X chromosome. The sperm which is fertilizing the egg, here I have written sperm, sorry, this should be male. The sperm carrying X chromosome, if it fertilizes the egg, resultant sex of the individual becomes female. If the egg carrying X chromosome is fertilized by the sperm carrying Y chromosome, the resultant karyotype becomes X and Y, and it leads to the development of a male child. Therefore, in humans, sex of the fetus, the sex is decided at the time of fertilization itself. Once the fertilization is completed, there will be no further chance of change in the sex of the growing fetus. The sex of the fetus is decided at the time of fertilization itself, and it is decided by the sperm, not decided by the egg, because all the eggs are carrying only X chromosome. The sperm which is carrying X chromosome, if it fertilizes the egg, it becomes XX and resultant individual is female. If the sperm carrying Y chromosome fertilizes the egg, the resultant individual becomes male with XY combination of chromosomes. Therefore, in humans, mother or female is not responsible for the sex of baby. Always the mother is blamed in the society for giving birth to the female child, but scientifically she is not responsible for the sex of the baby. Father or the male is responsible for sex of the baby, as the male is producing two different types of the sperms. Which sperm is fertilizing the egg? If the sperm carrying X chromosome fertilizes the egg, resultant individual is female. If the sperm carrying Y chromosome fertilizes the egg, resultant individual will be male. Therefore, the mother is not responsible for sex of the baby. Then moving to the next one. So once the fertilization is completed, whether the egg is fertilized by the sperm with the X chromosome or the egg is fertilized by the sperm with Y chromosome, that doesn't matter. Once the fertilization is completed, where it has occurred? In the ampullary region of fallopian tube, result in the formation of diploid zygote. This zygote undergoes repeated mitosis, and the process is called cleavage. Because zygote is unicellular structure, it is converting into multicellular structure without changing the number of chromosomes, so that it is dividing through the mitosis. Cleavage is represented by repeated mitotic divisions, and first mitosis, the unicellular zygote is converted into two-celled structure, then gets transformed into four-celled, like that 8-celled, then 16-celled, and the cells of this embryo, or the cells which are produced as a result of cleavage of the zygote, are called blastomeres. Remember, what are the blastomeres? These are the cells produced from zygote during cleavage. During cleavage, the cells which are produced from the zygote through the mitosis are called blastomeres. Here, one important term, the embryo with 8 to 16 blastomeres is called morula. When the zygote becomes 8 to 16 celled structure or 8 to 16 blastomeres, it is called morula. Again, morula undergoes repeated mitotic division and gives rise to the formation of the very important structure in the human reproduction. It is blastocyst, and this blastocyst, it moves into uterus. Up to this, the division of the zygote, the development of morula, all these are taking place in the fallopian tube from ampulla to the isthmus. And finally, once the blastocyst is produced from morula, it moves into the uterus. Then question is, why the blastocyst moves into uterus? Because it has to execute one more important process for the confirmation of pregnancy, for the maintenance of pregnancy, and it is nothing but the implantation. The implantation process is carried out by blastocyst so that it moves into the uterus. Before moving to the implantation, let us know what is this blastocyst. Blastocyst is a ball-like structure produced from morula. It is covered by trophoblast. Covering of the blastocyst is called trophoblast. It contains inner cell mass and a cavity called blastocoel. The cavity present in the blastocyst is called blastocoel. The covering of the blastocyst is called trophoblast and it contains inner cell mass. Then what is the function? Trophoblast, finally it participates in implantation. And from the inner cell mass, the inner cell mass develops into proper embryo. The embryo is finally developing from inner cell mass and implantation is carried out by the trophoblast. So this trophoblast is ball-like structure developing from morula. The blastocyst, finally when it reaches the uterus, this blastocyst gets embedded in the endometrium of uterus. This process is called implantation. The blastocyst gets embedded in the endometrium of uterus. The process is called implantation. This is how the fertilization occurs, gives rise to the formation of zygote. That zygote divides by mitosis in the process called cleavage, gives rise to the formation of morula, and morula develops blastocyst. Blastocyst gets attached to the endometrium of uterus. This is called implantation. Remember, if the implantation is failed, then there will be no confirmation or continuation of the pregnancy. For the continuation of the pregnancy, implantation is very important step. Even though the fertilization has taken place, but implantation is failed, then there will be no continuation of pregnancy in case of human beings. And remember, the sex of the fetus is decided at the time of fertilization itself, and it is decided by the male, not by the female. So here one diagram I would like to explain. This is the female gamete, egg. One sperm, all the sperms are trying to come in contact with the egg, but one fastly moving sperm has entered into the egg, executed the fertilization. It has transformed into 2-celled, 4-celled, 8 to 16 celled structure is called morula. Here you can see the egg is released from ovary. It has reached the ampulla. This part represents ampulla. When both egg and sperm are in the ampullary region, the fertilization is executed. The zygote starts cleavage, gets transformed into 2-celled, 4-celled, 8-celled, and finally it has converted into blastocyst. So here is the image or diagram of blastocyst, and this blastocyst, this is the endometrium of uterus. To this endometrium, blastocyst is attaching. The process is called implantation. Insemination, then egg and sperm simultaneously reach the ampullary region, result in the fertilization. Only one sperm enters into the egg. Remaining sperm entry is prevented by zona pellucida. When sperm enters into the egg, the secondary oocyte completes second meiotic division. It is also unequal, gives rise to the formation of larger ootid and smaller polar body. The sperm nucleus fuses with the egg nucleus, gives rise to the formation of zygote. That zygote undergoes repeated mitotic divisions called cleavage, gives rise to the formation of 2, 4, 8, 16 celled structure. When 8 to 16 celled structure is formed, it is called morula, and morula gets transformed into blastocyst. The covering of the blastocyst is called trophoblast. It contains the cavity called blastocoele. It also contains inner cell mass which develops into embryo, and trophoblast helps in implantation. Implantation is very important step in human reproduction. The blastocyst gets embedded in the endometrium of uterus. It is called implantation. So these are the things that I wanted to explain with respect to fertilization and implantation. I hope it is clear for you. Thank you. Hello dear students, let us continue the next bit of human reproduction. So in the previous video I explained about the fertilization in humans. In humans, the site of fertilization is ampullary region of fallopian tube or oviduct. The ampullary region is wider part of the fallopian tube. When sperm and egg simultaneously reach the ampullary region, they fuse with each other, resulting the fertilization. And the product of fertilization is diploid zygote. When sperm reaches the egg, acrosomal secretions help in the breaking of egg membranes, which are corona radiata and zona pellucida. Once the sperm enters into the egg, the secondary oocyte, just which has completed the meiosis 1, it will complete the meiosis 2, and meiosis 2 is unequal division like meiosis 1, gives rise to the formation of one larger haploid structure, ootid, which is the actual ovum, and one smaller haploid structure, it is a secondary polar body. Then finally, the sperm fuses with the nucleus of the sperm fuses with the egg nucleus and gives rise to the formation of diploid zygote. The zygote is unicellular structure. To get it transformed into embryo, multicellular embryo, it undergoes repeated mitotic divisions, and this represents cleavage. After every mitosis, the number of new cells are added so that it will be finally converted into 8 to 16 celled structure called morula, and morula gets transformed into blastocyst, which is having 32 cells. The blastocyst is a ball like structure. It is covered by the membrane called trophoblast. It contains a fluid filled cavity called blastocoele, and it contains inner cell mass. The trophoblast helps in implantation, and the inner cell mass gives rise to the formation of the embryo, as the inner cell mass contains stem cells. The stem cells are multipotent cells or pluripotent cells, which are able to produce all the remaining body cells in the human body. And finally, the blastocyst, when it reaches the uterus, it gets embedded in the endometrium of uterus. The process is called implantation. Even though the fertilization has taken place, if there is absence of implantation or implantation does not occur, in that case the pregnancy is not continued in case of human beings. Therefore, fertilization as well as implantation, both of them are very important to execute the pregnancy condition in case of human beings. So these are the things that you have studied. One more bit that I explained, sex of the individual is decided at the time of fertilization itself. Once the fertilization is completed, there is no chance of changing the sex of individual, and sex of the fetus is decided by type of the sperm fertilizing the egg. In humans, the male produces two different types of sperms. 50% or some of the sperms are carrying X chromosome and some of the sperms are carrying Y chromosome. All the eggs produced by the female during her reproductive phase all of them are carrying X chromosome. If the sperm carrying X chromosome fertilizes the egg with the X chromosome, the resultant individual becomes a female with XX chromosome along with the autosomes. If the sperm carrying Y chromosome fertilizes the egg, then chromosomal combination will be XY along with the autosomes and the resultant individual becomes male. Therefore, mother is not responsible for the fetus sex, or the female is not responsible for sex of the fetus. It is decided by the type of the sperm fertilizing the egg. So these are the things that I explained in the previous video. Let us go for the next bit of the chapter. It is also very important: pregnancy and embryonic development. Fertilization is followed by the very important step called implantation. The blastocyst gets embedded into the endometrium of uterus. The process is called implantation. Once the implantation is completed, on the trophoblast, the finger-like projections are produced. They are called chorionic villi. Again, the term is of importance. What are chorionic villi? These are the finger-like projections appearing on the trophoblast after implantation. Once the implantation is completed, on the trophoblast, the finger-like projections are produced and they represent the chorionic villi. Remember, the chorionic villi represent the first structure of placenta. Implantation completed, the completion of the implantation gives rise to the formation of chorionic villi on the trophoblast, and there starts the development of placenta. And here the chorionic villi are surrounded by uterine tissue as well as maternal blood. The entire chorionic villi, it is surrounded by the uterine tissue and it is surrounded by the maternal blood. The chorionic villi and the uterine tissue to become interdigited with each other and jointly form the structural and functional unit between the developing fetus and the maternal body, it is called placenta. The very, very important term in the human reproduction, placenta. What is placenta? Placenta is structural and functional unit between developing fetus and the maternal body. So placenta is temporary tissue. It is not the permanent structure that it is always present in the female body. Only at the time of pregnancy, the placenta develops and it is removed at the time of delivery. That is why human placenta is called deciduate, as it is completely removed at the time of pregnancy, or it comes out at the time of delivery. Hence the placenta is called deciduate. Then question is, how this placenta is formed? The placenta is formed by the joint association between membrane, extra embryonic membrane, and the uterine membrane. So what are extra embryonic membranes? These are the membranes produced from trophoblast. Let me clear this one in Kannada. Placenta permanent agi human female body ulaga irohanta structure alla. Implantation complete aadamele placenta development initiate aagtada. ಒನ್ಸ್ ದ ಬೇಬಿ ಈಸ್ ಡೆಲಿವರ್ಡ್ ಆ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಯುಟರಸ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಉಳಿಯಂಗಿಲ್ಲ, ಅದನ್ನು ರಿಮೂವ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ ಅಥವಾ ಅದು ಹೊರಗೆ ಬರ್ತದೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಡೆಸಿಡಿವೇಟ್. ಪರ್ಮನೆಂಟಾಗಿ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಉಳಿಯೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ಟೈಮ್ನಾಗ ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ, ಡೆಲಿವರಿ ಟೈಮ್ನಾಗ ಬಾಡಿಯಿಂದ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಆಗಿ ರಿಮೂವ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ, ಡೆಸಿಡಿವೇಟ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ಈ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಆಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಎರಡು ಥರದ್ದು ಟಿಶ್ಯೂಸದ್ದು ಇನ್ವಾಲ್ವ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇರ್ತದೆ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೋಸ್ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂಸ್ ಆರ್ ಒನ್ ಈಸ್ ಕೋರಿಯಾನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅನದರ್ ಈಸ್ ಎಂಡೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುಟೆರಸ್. ಕೋರಿಯಾನ್ ಈಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್, ದಟ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಇನ್ವಾಲ್ವ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಬಾಡಿ. ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಬಾಡಿನ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡುವಲ್ಲೇ ಈ ಕೋರಿಯಾನ್ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಸಿಪೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಂಗಿಲ್ಲ, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಇದನ್ನು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಎಷ್ಟು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಸ್ ಅವ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹೌ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್, ವಿಚ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸಿಂಗ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಸ್. ಟ್ರೋಫೋಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಕವರಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ ಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟೋಸಿಸ್ಟ್, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸಿಂಗ್ ದ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಸ್. ಈ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಹೆಸರೇ ಹೇಳ್ತದೆ, ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋನ ಹೊರತುಪಡಿಸಿ ಇರೋಹಂಥ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಸು. ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಟ್ರೋಫೋಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟು ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ನಾಲ್ಕು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಗಳು ಆಮ್ನಿಯಾನ್, ಕೋರಿಯಾನ್, ಅಲೆಂಟಾಯ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಯೋಕ್ ಸ್ಯಾಕ್. ಈ ನಾಲ್ಕಕ್ಕೂ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ವೈ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ನಾಟ್ ಮೆನ್ಷನ್ಡ್, ಎನ್ ಸಿ ಆರ್ ಟಿ ಬುಕ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಇಷ್ಟು ಡೀಟೇಲ್ ಆಗಿ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿಲ್ಲ, ಎಷ್ಟು ಬೇಕು ಸಿಲೆಬಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಅಷ್ಟನ್ನು ಮಾತ್ರ ಮೆನ್ಷನ್ ಮಾಡೀನಿ. ಈ ನಾಲ್ಕು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಮ್ರೇನ್ಸ್, ಒನ್ಸ್ ಅಗೇನ್ ಐ ರಿಪೀಟ್ ದ ನೇಮ್ಸ್, ಕೋರಿಯಾನ್, ಆಮ್ನಿಯಾನ್, ಅಲೆಂಟಾಯ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಯೋಕ್ ಸ್ಯಾಕ್. ಅದರೊಳಗೆ ಕೋರಿಯೋನು ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸಿಂಗ್ ದ ಫಿಂಗರ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಟ್ರೋಫೋಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ರೀಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ. ಈ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ಯುಟರಸ್ದ ಎಂಡೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಡೀಪಾಗಿ ಪೆನಿಟ್ರೇಟ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಜಾಯಿಂಟ್ಲಿ ಎಂಡೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್ಮು ಪ್ಲಸ್ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ಇವೆರಡೂ ಕೂಡಿಕೊಂಡು ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಆಗುವಂಥ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರಿಗೆ ಏನಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ. ಸೊ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಲ್ ಯುನಿಟ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ದ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಫೀಟಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೆಟರ್ನಲ್ ಬಾಡಿ. ಇಷ್ಟು ಡೆಫಿನೇಷನ್ ಬರೆದ್ರೆ ಸಾಕು. ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ? ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಲ್ ಯುನಿಟ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ದ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಫೀಟಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೆಟರ್ನಲ್ ಬಾಡಿ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹೌ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ಡ್? ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಇಂಟರ್ ಡಿಜಿಟೆಡ್ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಷನ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ದ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಯುಟೆರೈನ್ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂ. ಅಥವಾ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸರಳಾಗಿ ಇದನ್ನು ಬರೀಬೇಕು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ದ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಷನ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಯುಟೆರೈನ್ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂ ಜಾಯಿಂಟ್ಲಿ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಲ್ ಯುನಿಟ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ದ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಫೀಟಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೆಟರ್ನಲ್ ಬಾಡಿ. ಇದು ಟರ್ಮ್ ಬಹಳ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್, ಆ ಇಡೀ ಲೈನನ್ನು ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಆಗಿ ನೆನ್ಪಿಟ್ಕೋಬೇಕು. ದೆನ್ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ, ಯಾಕೆ ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು? ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವೈ ಇಟ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಸ್? ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಸಪ್ಲೈಸ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ರಿಕ್ವೈರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಫೀಟಸ್. ಯುಟೆರಸ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಆಗ್ತಿರೋಂಥ ಫೀಟಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಏನೇನು ರಿಕ್ವೈರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅದ ಫಾರ್ ದ ಪರ್ಪಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್, ಅದರದ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟಿಗೆ ಬೇಕಾದಂಥ ಆಕ್ಸಿಜನ್ನು, ನ್ಯೂಟ್ರಿಯಂಟ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ರಿಮೂವ್ಸ್ ದ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಡೈಆಕ್ಸೈಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಕ್ರೀಟರಿ ವೇಸ್ಟ್ ಫ್ರಾಮ್ ದ ಫೀಟಸ್. ಎರಡು ರೀತಿಯೂ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ. ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಮೆಟೀರಿಯಲ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಫೀಟಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಸಪ್ಲೈನೂ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫೀಟಸ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಆದಂಥ ವೇಸ್ಟ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಫೀಟಸ್ ಬಾಡಿಯಿಂದ ರಿಮೂವ್ ಮಾಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೂ ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ. ಇಟ್ ಸಪ್ಲೈಸ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಜನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ನ್ಯೂಟ್ರಿಯಂಟ್ಸ್ ಟು ದ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಫೀಟಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ರಿಮೂವ್ಸ್ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಡೈಆಕ್ಸೈಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಕ್ರೀಟರಿ ವೇಸ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಾಮ್ ದ ಫೀಟಸ್. ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೈ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ. The placenta is connected to the embryo through the umbilical cord. A placenta developing the embryo ke yadar through connect agirtada through the umbilical cord. The embryo transports nutrients and wastes to and from the placenta through the umbilical cord. ಈ umbilical cord placenta ಮತ್ತು embryoದ ನಡುವರ್ಕ್ connection ಅನ್ನು execute ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ. umbilical cord ಮುಖಾಂತರನೇ placenta oxygen and nutrients ಅನ್ನು embryoಗೆ supply ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ. ಅದೇ ಟೈಪ್ embryo body ಒಳಗಿದ್ದಂಥ carbon dioxide and excretory waste ಗಳನ್ನು umbilical cord ಮುಖಾಂತರನೇ embryo ಎದಕ್ಕೆ supply ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ ಅಥವಾ transport ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ placenta. So this is the connecting link between placenta and embryo. The very important term, ಇದು ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ ಆ್ಯನ್ಯುವಲ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಮ್ನಾಗ ಬಂದಂಥ ಕ್ವಶನ್ನು, ಇದನ್ನು ಕಂಪಲ್ಸರಿ ನೆನ್ಪಿಟ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕೆ ಬೇಕು. ಈಗ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ನ್ಯೂಟ್ರಿಯಂಟ್ಸನ್ನ ಸಪ್ಲೈ ಮಾಡ್ತದ, ಆಕ್ಸಿಜನನ್ನು ಸಪ್ಲೈ ಮಾಡ್ತದ, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ರಿಮೂವ್ಸ್ ದ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಡೈಆಕ್ಸೈಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಕ್ರೀಟರಿ ವೇಸ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಫೀಟಸ್. ಅಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್, ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಫಂಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಆನ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್. ಇದನ್ನು ಗ್ಯೂ ರೀಸನ್ ಒಳಗೂ ಕೇಳಬಹುದು. ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಫಂಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಆನ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಜಸ್ಟಿಫೈ ದ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅಥವಾ ಗ್ಯೂ ರೀಸನ್ ವೈ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ಸೇಡ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಿಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ಆನ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್. ಆಲ್ ದ ಥ್ರೀ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್ಸ್ ಇದರೊಳಗೆ ಯಾವುದೇ ಪ್ಯಾಟರ್ನಾಗ ಬಂದ್ರೂ ಆನ್ಸರ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್. ವೈ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ಸೇಡ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಿಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ಆನ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್. ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾನ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಗೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಕಂಪೇರ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಥವಾ ಕಂಪೇರ್ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ? ವಾಟ್ ಆರ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸ್? ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಡಕ್ಟ್ಲೆಸ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸ್ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟಿಂಗ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್. ಯಾವ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡು ಹಾರ್ಮೋನನ್ನು ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಏನಂತ ಕರಿತೀವಿ? ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಅಂತ ಕರಿತೀವಿ. ದೆನ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾಕೆ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾಕೆ ಆ ರೀತಿ ಕಂಪ್ಯಾರಿಸನ್, ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾಕೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಅಂತ ರೆಫರ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು? ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸಸ್ ಸೆವೆರಲ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಸಚ್ ಆಸ್ HCG. ಸಿ, ದ ರೀಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್. HCG ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಲೆಟರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಜಿ ಇನ್ ದ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಫಾರ್ಮ್. ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಕೋರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಗೊನಾಡೋಟ್ರೋಪಿನ್, ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಯಾನ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ HCG, ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಕೋರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಗೊನಾಡೋಟ್ರೋಪಿನ್. ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಒನ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್. HPL, ನಾಟ್ IPL, IPL ಅಂತ ಬರಿಬೇಡ್ರಿ ಮತ್ತೆ. HPL, ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಲ್ ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಟೋಜನ್. ಈಸ್ಟ್ರೋಜನ್ಸ್, ಪ್ರೊಜೆಸ್ಟಿರಾನ್, ಆಲ್ ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟೆಡ್ ಫ್ರಾಮ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಆರ್ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ. ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಬರೀ ನ್ಯೂಟ್ರಿಯಂಟ್ಸನ್ನು ಆಕ್ಸಿಜನನ್ನು ಸಪ್ಲೈ ಮಾಡೋದಾಗಲಿ ಅಥವಾ ಕಾರ್ಬನ್ ಡೈಆಕ್ಸೈಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಕ್ರೀಟರಿ ಪ್ರಾಡಕ್ಟ್ಗಳನ್ನು ರಿಮೂವ್ ಮಾಡೋದಾಗಲಿ ಮಾಡೋದ್ರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಎಡಿಷ್ನಲಿ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಿಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ಆ್ಯನ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟ್ಸ್ ಸಮ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಸಚ್ ಆಸ್ HCG, ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಕೋರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಗೊನಾಡೋಟ್ರೋಫಿನ್, ದೆನ್ HPL, ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಲ್ ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಟೋಜನ್, ಈಸ್ಟ್ರೋಜನ್ಸ್, ಪ್ರೊಜೆಸ್ಟಿರಾನ್. ಆಲ್ ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ. ಇದು ಎರಡೂ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ಯಾಟ್ ಒಳಗೆ ನೆನ್ಪಿಟ್ಕೋಬೇಕು. ನೇಮ್ ದ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ: HCG, HPL, ಈಸ್ಟ್ರೋಜನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಸ್ಟಿರಾನ್. ವೈ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ಸೇಡ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಿಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ಆನ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್? ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟ್ಸ್ ಸೆವೆರಲ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಸಚ್ ಆಸ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಕೋರಿಯಾನಿಕ್ ಗೊನಾಡೋಟ್ರೋಫಿನ್, ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಲ್ ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಟೋಜನ್, ಈಸ್ಟ್ರೋಜನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಸ್ಟಿರಾನ್. ಹೆನ್ಸ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಈಸ್ ಸೇಡ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಿಂಗ್ ಆಸ್ ಆನ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್. ದೆನ್ ಫೈನಲಿ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಲೇಟರ್ ಫೇಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ, ಅಂದರೆ ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ಟ್ರೈಮೆಸ್ಟರ್ 9th month ಹತ್ರ ಬಂದಂಗೆ, ಅನದರ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ರಿಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಸಿನ್ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ದ ಓವರಿ. ಓವರಿಯಿಂದ ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ, ಅದನ್ನು ರಿಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಸಿನ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ಇವಿಷ್ಟು ಹಾರ್ಮೋನುಗಳು ದೇ ಆರ್ ಎಡಿಷ್ನಲಿ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟೆಡ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ. ದೆನ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ಈಗ ಹೇಳಿರೋ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಗಳನ್ನು ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಸಮ್ ಅದರ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಬಾಡಿ. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಈಸ್ಟ್ರೋಜನ್, ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಸ್, ಪ್ರೊಜೆಸ್ಟಿರಾನ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಸ್, ಕಾರ್ಟಿಸಾಲ್, ಥೈರಾಕ್ಸಿನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಟಿನ್. ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಅದರ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಹೂಸ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಸ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ. ಸೊ ಡೋಂಟ್ ಗೆಟ್ ಕನ್ಫ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ನೇಮ್ಸ್. ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಲ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಅಂದಾಗ ಹೆಚ್ ಸಿ ಜಿ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ಗೊನಾಡೋಟ್ರೋಫಿನ್ ಹೆಚ್ ಪಿ ಎಲ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಲ್ ಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಟೋಜನ್ ಈಸ್ಟ್ರೋಜನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಸ್ಟಿರೋನ್ ಆ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಸ್ಟಿರೋನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಈಸ್ಟ್ರೋಜನ್ನನ್ನು ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟನೂ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ ಈವನ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ರೀಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಟಿವ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಓವರಿಯಿಂದನೂ ಇವೆರಡೂ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟ್ ಆಗ್ತವೆ ಇದರ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಕಾರ್ಟಿಸಾಲ್ ಥೈರಾಕ್ಸಿನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಟಿನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಅದರ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಹೂಸ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಸ್ ಆಟ್ ದ ಟೈಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಹೆಲ್ಪಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಮೆಂಟೆನೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ಇಟ್ ಸಪೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಫೀಟಲ್ ಗ್ರೋಥ್ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಆಸ್ ದ ಮೆಟಬಾಲಿಕ್ ಚೇಂಜಸ್ ದಟ್ ಆಕರ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಬಾಡಿ ಆಫ್ ಅ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಗಳ ಲೆವೆಲ್ಲು ಹೆಚ್ಚಾಗೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ಮೆಂಟೈನ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಆಗ್ತಿರೋ ಫೀಟಸ್ದು ಗ್ರೋಥ್ ಪ್ರಾಪರ್ ಆಗಿ ನಡೀತದೆ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆಂಟ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಒಳಗೆ ಆಗುವಂಥ ಮೆಟಬಾಲಿಕ್ ಚೇಂಜ್ಗಳಿಗೂ ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸು ಸಪೋರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾವೆ ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಸ್ ಹೂಸ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಸ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಗ್ನೆನ್ಸಿ ದೆನ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ದ ಇಂಪ್ಲಾಂಟೇಷನ್ ಈಸ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟೆಡ್ ದ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಒಂದ್ಸರಿ ಇಂಪ್ಲಾಂಟೇಷನ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಆದರೆ ಇಮಿಡಿಯೇಟಾಗಿ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ತ್ರೀ ಜರ್ಮ್ ಲೇಯರ್ಸ್ ಔಟರ್ ಎಕ್ಟೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಎಂಡೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೀಸೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಇವೆರಡು ಆದಮೇಲೆ ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಈ ಮೂರು ಜರ್ಮ್ ಲೇಯರ್ಸು ಡೆವಲಪ್ ಆಗ್ತವೆ ಸೊ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದೀಸ್ ಜರ್ಮ್ ಲೇಯರ್ಸ್ ದ ರಿಮೇನಿಂಗ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಲೇಟರ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಸೊ ಇಂಪ್ಲಾಂಟೇಷನ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಆದ ತಕ್ಷಣವೇ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಏನಾಗಿ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಜರ್ಮ್ ಲೇಯರ್ಸ್ ಆಗಿ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಾಟ್ ಆರ್ ದೋಸ್ ಜರ್ಮ್ ಲೇಯರ್ಸ್ ಎಕ್ಟೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಎಂಡೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೀಸೋಡರ್ಮ್ ದೆನ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್ ಈಸ್ ಹೌ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಪಾಸಿಬಲ್ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಯಾಕೆ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ ಆಯಿತು ಅದರೊಳಗೆ ಯಾವ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ತಾವೆ ದ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಈಸ್ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಫ್ರಾಮ್ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟೋಸಿಸ್ಟಿಗೆ ಟ್ರೋಫೋಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟು ಔಟರ್ ಲೇಯರು ಅದರ ಒಳಗಿರೋಂಥ ಯಾವುದು ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಸೊ ಹಿಯರ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಟ್ರೋಫೋಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ಔಟರ್ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಕವರಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟೋಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೀಸ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ರೀಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟಿಂಗ್ ದ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫ್ರಾಮ್ ದ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ದ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಈಸ್ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಸೊ ನೌ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ರೆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಟು ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಎಂಥ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ತಾವೆ ಇನ್ ದ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ದ ಸ್ಟೆಮ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಸ್ಟೆಮ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಯಾವೋ ಈಗ ಪ್ಲಾಂಟ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಒಳಗೆ ಹೆಂಗೆ ಮೆರಿಸ್ಟಮ್ಯಾಟಿಕ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸು ಆ್ಯಕ್ಟಿವ್ ಆಗಿ ಡಿವೈಡ್ ಆಗಿ ಬೇರೆ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂಗಳನ್ನು ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾವೆ ಸಿಮಿಲರ್ಲಿ ದ ಸ್ಟೆಮ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಬಾಡಿ ದೆ ಡಿವೈಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೆ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಎನಿ ಅದರ್ ಬಾಡಿ ಸೆಲ್ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಈ ಸೆಲ್ಗಳಿಗೆ ಪ್ಲ್ಯೂರಿಪೋಟೆಂಟ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ ಇವು ಯಾವಾಗಲೂ ಡಿವೈಡ್ ಆಗ್ತಿರ್ತಾವೆ ಇದರಿಂದ ಎಲ್ಲ ಬಾಡಿ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ಗಳು ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ ಆಗ್ತವೆ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೀಸ್ ಸ್ಟೆಮ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಮೆನ್ಷನ್ಡ್ ಎಬಿಲಿಟಿ ಟು ಗಿವ್ ರೈಸ್ ಟು ಆಲ್ ದ ಟಿಶ್ಯೂಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಬಾಡಿ ಇಂಥ ಸ್ಟೆಮ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸು ಎಲ್ಲಿ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಅವ ಇನ್ನರ್ ಸೆಲ್ ಮಾಸ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಅವ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೈ ಒನ್ಸ್ ದ ಇಂಪ್ಲಾಂಟೇಷನ್ ಈಸ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟೆಡ್ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಷಿಯೇಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಜರ್ಮ್ ಲೇಯರ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಎಕ್ಟೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಎಂಡೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೀಸೋಡರ್ಮ್ ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಟುಡೇ ಐ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಇಂಪ್ಲಾಂಟೇಷನ್ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಕರ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಟ್ರೋಫೋಬ್ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ದ ಫಿಂಗರ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ರೀಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಾ ಸೊ ಹಿಯರ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ಇನ್ ದ ಇಮೇಜ್ ಪ್ಲಸೆಂಟಲ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ದ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ಫಿಂಗರ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಪ್ರೊಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ ದೀಸ್ ಕೋರಿಯೋನಿಕ್ ವಿಲ್ಲೈ ಆರ್ ಎಂಬೆಡೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಎಂಡೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಯೂಟೆರಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಬೋತ್ ಆಫ್ ದೆಮ್ ಆರ್ ಟುಗ್ಯಾದರ್ ಫಾರ್ಮಿಂಗ್ ದ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫಂಕ್ಷನಲ್ ಕನೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಎಂಬ್ರಿಯೋ ದ ಡೆವಲಪಿಂಗ್ ಫೀಟಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮದರ್ This represents the placenta, and placenta is connected to the growing fetus with the help of umbilical cord. Through the umbilical cord only, the oxygen and nutrients are supplied. Here, the umbilical cord contains the blood vessels and carbon dioxide and wastes, excretory wastes are also removed through the umbilical cord. This is the growing fetus. This is small one, yolk sac. It don't have any specific function in the humans, and it is uterine cavity. The size of uterine cavity increases month by month during the pregnancy. This is how the position of the embryo is observed in the pregnant female. Then, what are the fetal developmental stages? Month by month, how the changes are occurring? This is the fertilized zygote. So, during cleavage, transformed into 2-celled stage, 4-celled stage, 8-celled stage, 16-celled morula, and morula gets transformed into blastocyst. Blastocyst undergoes implantation. After implantation, chorionic villi is produced, and this is the image of 4 weeks fetus, 10 weeks fetus, 16 weeks fetus, and 20 weeks fetus. Month wise and week wise it is shown in the image. Here you can see, this is the fully grown fetus. The transparent membrane that you can see around the fetal body, it is amniotic sac. Inside the amniotic sac, amniotic fluid is present, in which the fetus is in the swing condition. That means the entire body is covered by that amniotic fluid. Remember the term amniotic sac and amniotic fluid. Here you can see the placental structure. This represents umbilical cord, and this is how it appears in the ultrasound scanning. This is the image taken through the scanning. And what are the important developments? First month, heart is formed. Second month, limbs and digits, kai mattu kaalu, adara beralugalu. Third month, major organ systems are formed. Fifth month, appearance of hair on the head. In the fifth month, the hair appears on the head. So during fifth month, the hair on the head. Then yes, now it is clear. During sixth month, during fifth month, hair on the head and first movement of the fetus. Remember, during fifth month of the pregnancy, the first movement of the fetus occur, and sixth month, body is covered with fine hair, eyelids separate, eyelashes are formed, and by the ninth month, the fetus is fully developed and it is ready for the delivery. So you need to remember these points. First month olage enagtada, second month vital changes enava, third month, fifth month, sixth month and ninth month. The first movement is during the fifth month. And what are the hormones secreted by placenta? Overall, what are the different hormones whose level increases during the pregnancy? Placenta andre enu, placenta ka endocrine gland anta yaka compare madtara. All these things you need to remember with respect to the pregnancy and embryonic development. Hope this explanation is clear for you. Thank you. Hello dear students, this is the last bit of the chapter human reproduction. So let us go for the remaining terms and process. So the human reproduction, last part, parturition and lactation. So before this one, you have studied about the process of fertilization in humans, how the zygote gets converted into blastocyst, what is implantation, what is placenta, and what are the different functions carried out by the placenta. Placenta is temporary tissue which is produced by association between the extra embryonic membrane produced from the trophoblast and endometrium of uterus. It supplies oxygen and nutrients to the developing fetus. At the same time, it collects the wastes as well as carbon dioxide from the developing fetus. It also acts as endocrine gland because the placenta secretes very important hormones, HCG, human chorionic gonadotropin, HPL, human placental lactogen, estrogen and progesterone. All these are the important hormones that helps in the maintenance of pregnancy. So finally, the last bit of human reproduction. Parturation and lactation. What is parturation? Before going to the definition, one more term you need to understand. It is gestation period. The average duration of pregnancy is called as gestation period, and in humans the gestation period is for 9 months. So gestation period andre total period of pregnancy, for how many days the embryo gets finally transformed into the fetus, complete baby, that period of pregnancy is called gestation period. The average duration of the pregnancy is called gestation period, and in humans the gestation period is 9 months. So again, it is 1 mark question. What is parturation? Parturation occurs at the end of pregnancy. If there is no complication, if there is no miscarriage or abortion, the parturation occurs at the end or completion of gestation period. The vigorous contractions of uterus at the end of the pregnancy causes delivery of the fetus, and it is called parturation. Simple thing, giving birth to the fully developed fetus. For 9 months a fetus mother uterus olaga develop aagtirtade, complete aagi beladantha fetus mother uterus inda deliver aagi horag bandre, that is called parturation. And parturation is due to vigorous contraction of the uterus, and that occurs at the end of pregnancy. And one more thing, parturation is induced by neuroendocrine mechanism. Andre at the time of parturation, uterus do myometrium, hope you remember the layers of uterus, perimetrium, outer layer, myometrium, middle layer, endometrium, inner layer. So endometrium ellelli involve aithiga, endometrium implantation ig involve aitu, endometrium placenta formation madlike help madtu, myometrium adu function enu already idu one sari annual exam olaga 1 mark question ige bandantaddu. What is the function of myometrium, or which layer of the uterus undergo the vigorous contraction during parturation? ಪಾರ್ಚುರೇಷನ್ ಆಗಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಅಥವಾ ಬೇಬಿ ಡೆಲಿವರಿ ಆಗಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಯುಟೆರಸ್ದು ಯಾವ ಲೇಯರು ವಿಗರಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಎಂಟರ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ ಅಥವಾ ವಿಗರಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನನ್ನು ತೋರಿಸ್ತದೆ. ಆನ್ಸರ್ ಈಸ್ ಮಯೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್. ದ ಮಸಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಮಯೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್ ಅಂಡರ್ಗೋ ವಿಗರಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಡ್ಯೂ ಟು ದ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲೂಯೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯೂಟರಿ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್. ದ ಪಿಟ್ಯೂಟರಿ ಈಸ್ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಗ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ವಿಚ್ ಈಸ್ ಲೊಕೇಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಬ್ರೇನ್. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಡಿವೈಡೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಟೂ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ಎಂಟೀರಿಯರ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯೂಟರಿ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪೋಸ್ಟೀರಿಯರ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯೂಟರಿ. ಎಡಿನೋಹೈಪೋಫೈಸಿಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ನ್ಯೂರೋಹೈಪೋಫೈಸಿಸ್. ಆ ಪೋಸ್ಟೀರಿಯರ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯೂಟರಿ ಇಂದ ದ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್, ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್ ಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಅಂಡರ್ ದ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲೂಯೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್ ದ ಮಯೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುಟೆರಸ್ ಅಂಡರ್ಗೋಸ್ ವಿಗರಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಸಪೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಪಾರ್ಚುರೇಷನ್. ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೈ ಪಾರ್ಚುರೇಷನ್ ಈಸ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ನ್ಯೂರೋ ಎಂಡೋಕ್ರೈನ್ ಮೆಕ್ಯಾನಿಸಮ್. ಈ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಯಾಕೆ ಹೇಳ್ತದೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ಪಾರ್ಚುರೇಷನ್ ಆಗಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಯುಟೆರಸ್ದ ಮಯೋಮೆಟ್ರಿಯಮ್ಮು ವಿಗರಸ್ ಆಗಿ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ವಿಗರಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಈಸ್ ಇಂಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಡೆಫಿನೇಷನ್ ಫಾರ್ ಪಾರ್ಚುರೇಷನ್. One more very important definition with relation to parturation. The signals for parturation originate from fully developed fetus and the placenta, which induce mild uterine contractions called fetal ejection reflex. Again, very very important one mark question. What is fetal ejection reflex? Fetus, fully grown, the baby, fully developed baby, at the end of parturation, it is delivered. Fetus horage barabekadre, kelavandu mechanisms mother body olaga generate aagtava, athava induce aagtava. Signals for parturation, delivery kintanu munche, some signals are shown by the pregnant female, and those signals for the parturation ellinda originate aagtava, they are originated from fully developed fetus, andre complete aagi grow aagirohanta fetus and the placenta. Eradu placenta also induces the signals for parturation. Even the fully developed fetus also induces the signals for parturation, and both of them are responsible for mild uterine contraction. This is called fetal ejection reflex. The signals for parturation originate from the fully developed fetus and placenta, which induce the mild uterine contractions. It is called fetal ejection reflex. So try to remember the definition. When fetal ejection reflex starts, this phenomenon or the process triggers the release of oxytocin from mother's pituitary. Onesari parturation time andre at the end of the pregnancy, gestation period end aad takshna, yavaga ee fetal ejection reflex start aagtada, avaga ಮದರ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯುಟರಿಯಿಂದ ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್ ಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ರೆಸ್ಪಾನ್ಸಿಬಲ್ ಫಾರ್ ವಿಗರಸ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್. ಮೈಲ್ಡ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಯುಟೆರೈನ್ ಮಸಲ್ಸ್ ಇದ್ದದ್ದು ವಿಗರಸ್ ಅಂದರೆ ಸ್ಲೋ ಆಗಿ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗ್ತಿರೋವಂಥ ಯುಟೆರೈನ್ ಮಸಲ್ಸು ಫಾಸ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾವೆ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮದರ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯುಟರಿ ಟ್ರಿಗರ್ ಆಗಿ ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್ ರಿಲೀಸ್ ಆಗಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಮೊದಲು ಏನು ಸೆಟ್ ಆಗಬೇಕಲ್ಲೇ, ದೇರ್ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿ ದ ಫೀಟಲ್ ಇಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ ರಿಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್. ಒನ್ಸ್ ದ ಫೀಟಲ್ ಇಜೆಕ್ಷನ್ ರಿಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟೆಡ್, ಇಟ್ ಟ್ರಿಗರ್ಸ್ ದ ಮದರ್ಸ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯುಟರಿ ಟು ರಿಲೀಸ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಟೋಸಿನ್. And this oxytocin, which is released from mother's pituitary, it stimulates stronger uterine contractions. Slow agi contract aagthirohanta uterine the myometrium under the influence of oxytocin fast agi contract aaglikke start maadtada, which in turn yavaga uterine muscles fast aage contract aaglikke start maadtava, that also stimulates more and more production of oxytocin. Innu hechige oxytocin secrete aaglikke start maadtada, and this stimulatory positive feedback reflex continues between uterine contractions and oxytocin secretion. So let me explain this sentence. Stimulatory positive feedback. In the human body, the homeostasis. What is homeostasis? Constant maintenance of internal environment. Andra body olagade irohanta environment na constant agi maintain maadbeku. Whether it is electrolyte balance, it is amount of the water, temperature, all these factors are constantly maintained, and it is the ability of the organism. Adu tanashtakane self agi maintain agohanta vandu mechanism idna homeostasis anta karitara. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನೆಗೆಟಿವ್ ಫೀಡ್ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಅನ್ನು ನೋಡ್ತೀವಿ, ಪಾಸಿಟಿವ್ ಫೀಡ್ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಅನ್ನು ನೋಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಸೆ ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್, ದ ರೆಗ್ಯುಲೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಪರ್ಮ್ಯಾಟೋಜೆನೇಸಿಸ್ ಇನ್ ಮೇಲ್ಸ್. ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ ಇದು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ ಮಾಡಿರುವಂಥ ಪಾರ್ಟ್. ಮೇಲ್ಸ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಸ್ಪರ್ಮ್ಯಾಟೋಜೆನೇಸಿಸ್ ರೆಗ್ಯುಲೇಟ್ ಆಗಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ನಾಲ್ಕು ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಒಂದು GnRH, ಸಿಕ್ರೀಟೆಡ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಹೈಪೋಥಲಾಮಸ್. ಅದು ಎಲ್ಲಿ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತದೆ? ಇಟ್ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ದ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯೂಟರಿ, ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪಿಟ್ಯೂಟರಿಯಿಂದ ಎರಡು ಹಾರ್ಮೋನ್ ರಿಲೀಸ್ ಆಗ್ತವೆ, FSH ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ LH. FSH ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ LH ಇನ್ ಟರ್ನ್ ದೇ ಸ್ಟಿಮ್ಯುಲೇಟ್ ದ ಸರ್ಟೋಲಿ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಲೇಡಿಗ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸ್. ಲೇಡಿಗ್ ಸೆಲ್ಸನ್ನ LH ಸ್ಟಿಮ್ಯುಲೇಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಇಟ್ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಟೆಸ್ಟೋಸ್ಟಿರೋನ್. ಬಟ್ ವೆನ್ ಟೆಸ್ಟೋಸ್ಟಿರೋನ್ ಲೆವೆಲ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಸ್, ಇಟ್ ಸಪ್ರೆಸಸ್ ದ ಹೈಪೋಥಲಾಮಸ್ to stop the secretion of GnRH. Andre yavaga testosterone level body valage increase aagtada, hypothalamus inda GnRH secretion enagilik start aagtada, reduce aaglikke start aagtada. This I can take the example for negative feedback. Andre ondu hormone level increase aagi mattondu hormone production kadime aaglikatre, it is negative feedback. But here en explain madade, when the uterine contraction increases, when uterine muscles undergo vigorous contraction, it stimulates the pituitary for the production of more oxytocin. Andre uterine contraction jaasti aadanga oxytocin production ille kadime aaglikattilla, en aaglikattada increase aaglikattada. More uterine contraction, more will be the production of oxytocin. That is why it is example for positive feedback, and it continues between uterine contraction and oxytocin secretion. As the uterine muscles undergo more and more vigorous contraction, the pituitary is stimulated to secrete more and more oxytocin, and finally this helps in parturation, that is giving birth to fully developed fetus. So at the end of all this phenomenon, the fully developed fetus, that is baby, it is expelled out of the uterus through the birth canal. The birth canal is produced by the cervix and vagina, and through that birth canal finally the fully developed baby is expelled out of the uterus. And soon after the fetus is delivered, placenta is also delivered out of the uterus. Once a fully developed fetus deliver agi मदर यूटरस बंद्रे इवन प्लसेंटा इज आल्सो डेलिवर्ड आउट ऑफ द यूटरस अंद्रे पार्चुरेशन मुगद तक्षणाने प्लसेंटा इज आल्सो कमिंग आउट ऑफ द यूटरस दैट इज वाई द प्लसेंटा इज कॉल्ड temporary tissue because permanently it is not present in the human female. When female is in the pregnancy condition, implantation aadaga athwa after implantation simultaneously a placental development start aagthada and parturation aagbekadra along with the baby the placenta is also delivered out of the uterus. Then last two very important definitions of the chapter, lactation and colostrum. What is lactation? The production of milk by the mammary glands towards the end of the pregnancy is called lactation. Pregnancy in human females, it is also associated with the changes in the function of mammary glands. That is why the mammary glands are studied along with the female reproductive system. In the non-pregnant female, the mammary glands are in inactive condition. Even though mammary glands are present, if the female is in not pregnancy condition, they are not activated for the production of milk. During pregnancy, due to hormonal changes in the female body, the mammary glands are activated, and at the end of pregnancy, that means after parturation, when the baby is delivered by the mother, the milk production will be started by the mammary glands yavaga towards the end of pregnancy. This is called lactation. Production of milk by the mammary glands towards the end of the pregnancy is called lactation. Then last definition, colostrum. The milk produced during initial few days of lactation is called colostrum. It is rich in antibodies that provide resistance and immunity to the newborn. What is colostrum? Once the lactation starts, the milk which is produced during initial few days of lactation, after giving birth to the baby, modulo few days tanaka en milk production aagtada by the mammary glands, adanna matra en ant karitara, it is called colostrum. Not the continuous milk production. The entire milk which is produced for few months by the mammary gland is not termed as colostrum. Only for initial few days after giving birth to the young one, adanna matra colostrum anta karitaru. And feeding this colostrum to the baby is very important because baby body full develop agirthada, but adak immunity agli external प्रेशर स्ट्रेस टॉलरेट एबिलिटी आगे इरंगा. इट इस वेरी डेलिकेट. ऑफ कोर्स इट इस फुली डेवलप्ड फीटस ओनली. दैट इस वाई इट इस पार्चुरेटेड और इट इस डेलिवर्ड. आ बेबी के इन रेजिस्टेंस पावर इम्यूनिटी बरबेको अंतंद्रे मदर हैज टू फीड हर मिल्क especially for initial few days because the colostrum contains antibodies that provides the resistance to newborn. The milk produced during initial few days of the lactation is called colostrum, and lactation is production of the milk by the mammary glands towards the end of the pregnancy. It is called lactation. So these are the terms which are included in the last bit of the topic with the title parturation and lactation. So that completes the topic human reproduction. Hope it is clear for you. Thank you.